So good evening, everyone. Before we start, I just pasted two links in the chat box. These are links for the YouTube channel which the International Federation of Rural Surgeons have. One is for health education for rural doctors. The other one is for health education for patients. Both would be quite useful. And please do subscribe to these two channels and you can benefit from it. And even this meeting and summaries of these sort of meetings, will put it up there. Okay, by the time we are waiting, these are meetings which we plan to conduct every Sunday around 8:30 in Indian time. The reason for conducting is that the rural surgery is a little different from the surgery which is practiced in medical colleges or in urban areas. So we need to make few adaptations to suit surgical practice in rural areas. So we have got people from the medical colleges. We had Dr. Peter Rins from Netherlands, who's representing International Federation of Rural Surgeons, and some from African countries also will be joining us. So we'll all discuss and find out which is the optimal or best way of treating these conditions in rural areas. Today we're going to discuss about hemorrhoids and how we manage in rural areas. But I think there are too many people to introduce each one of us. And I'm not able to make out whether the senior rural surgeons have joined it. I can see Dr. Opinar and any other rural surgery veterans who joined.
I am also finding, I am searching.
Yeah. Dr. Peter Rims, can you introduce yourself to the group, please? Nice to have you join us.
Yes, hello. My name is Peter Rims. I'm a surgeon from the Netherlands. And I've been working together with Dr. Ganaraj a long time in the International Federation of Rural Surgery and with the IRSI. And I basically was a surgical oncologist in a big Dutch teaching hospital, but now I'm working as a freelance surgeon for the ICRC, which is the International Red Cross, and in rural areas, mainly in the Caribbean, in Northern Scotland, and St. Helena and Falklands. So nice to be here with you. And being interested what will be presented about hemorrhoids.
Thanks, Dr. Reams. Dr. Opinaran, probably you can introduce yourself and we look for any other rural surgeons around.
I am Dr. Opinaran from Ranchi. I worked in different small hospitals of periphery of Jharkhand and MP. I am general surgeon.
Okay, thank you. So if any of you need any explanations or need any comments, or if you'd like to share something, you're welcome to stop me at any time. So today we're going to discuss how we're going to manage hemorrhoids in rural area. But before that, this is just a short presentation about what is happening. See, we finished my undergraduate and postgraduate studies a few decades ago. And it looks as though when I'm preparing this slide, a lot of things seem to change over the years. So what is hemorrhoids? Can anyone give me an answer? I suppose you can read it here also, but before that, what idea do you have of hemorrhoids? Anybody can just unmute and answer.
So swollen veins in lower rectum.
Okay, so it's basically what is called anal cushions. So these are abnormal and it causes prolapse and bleeding from it. And there are three major cushions, one on the left side, which is called left lateral, and two on the right side, one anterior and one posterior. So classically, they say the hemorrhoids occur in the 3 o'clock position, 11 o'clock and 6 or 7 o'clock positions. And the pathology is that it's actually, combination of degeneration of the elastic fibers which are there in the anal cushions. And these muscles and elastic fibers rupture, which leads to venous dilatation. And whenever there is venous dilatation and stasis, there is bound to be thrombosis. And also when there is extravasation, thrombosis, there are a fair amount of inflammation. So all these compound each other and finally cause this dilated anal cushions, which also prolapse because there is no support. And can cause minimal rupture and bleeding, which is one of the most common symptoms of hemorrhoids. So what causes these hemorrhoids? There are some predisposing factors like prolonged sitting or straining during passing stools. And now several studies have shown that there is a high blood flow in the superior rectal artery. And this also contributes to the development of the hemorrhoids. So here's a picture here. So this dentate line, and what is above the dentate line is called the internal hemorrhoids, and what is below is called the external hemorrhoids. And how common is it? So anybody from the audience, is it a common problem in your area? How often do you see it?
So we find patients of piles.
Yeah. See, most of the, actually, if you look at the studies reports from UK, they given from 13 to 36% prevalence in adult males, which is almost one third. Every third person has hemorrhoids, which actually may not be true because these are all self-reported studies. People ring up and ask them, do they have any symptoms which are related to your bottom? And many of them do have, but whatever be the cause, whether there's any pain, the bleeding, or increased flatulence, everything, people report it as hemorrhoids. With piles or hemorrhoids is a common terminology they use. In one of the studies done in US, they found that 4.4% of the adults have hemorrhoids. But this study involved actual examination. And in India and many of the LMICs, the reported incidence is about 11%. What it tells us is that it's a very common problem. It might be very significant or may not be significant, but symptoms are there in most of the people. So the types, as I mentioned earlier, it's a dentate line which divides hemorrhoids into external or internal hemorrhoid. And of course, it can, if both are there, it's a combined type. Okay, so before going to the grading, probably, I'd like to check with you how you have understood. So what are the prevalence? How common is it? Can somebody answer, please?
It is very much common. As statistics, I cannot tell, but it may be 30-40% of cases.
Okay, so some of them feel that in India also it is very common. Almost every third or every fourth person will have some symptom of hemorrhoids. Okay, and why does it occur? Do they always have predisposing factors, or they might or might not have?
So the chronic constipation and straining.
Okay. So is it a new phenomenon, or has it been, especially the older generation surgeons here? Has the incidence increased over the years, or has it been the same? Okay, I think we'll stop sharing for a while. So what do you think of the incidence? Has it been increasing, or has it been remaining the same? Okay, before we move on, I'd like Dr. Elijah to sort of introduce herself. I think I see Dr. Jacobson also. Please introduce if you want the senior ARSM members to introduce.
Yes, good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah, my name is Dr. Elijah from Kenya. in Africa.
Thank you. So today we're discussing about hemorrhoids. How common are they in Kenya? Are they also quite common? Because we've just been looking at the studies. USA incidence has given us 4.4%. UK in self-reported studies, 13 to 36%. LMS is about 10%. What about African countries? How common or uncommon is it?
Yeah, I would say I don't have a figure, but it's pretty common to the extent that, you know, every week we have a few, up to five patients with hemorrhoid problems. Yeah.
Okay, so that's also quite interesting. So we are starting with discussing a common problem. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. How do you grade the hemorrhoids? So the pathology we said was that it's an anal cushion which slides down or prolapses. So grade one obviously is the grade which is mild. So there is no prolapse of the hemorrhoid beyond the anal canal. And grade two, it prolapses and comes out of the anal canal during defecation, because that is the time when people strain. And along with motion, some streaking of blood also will be there. But then after defecation, it spontaneously reduces. This is a grade two. And grade three is you need to manually push the hemorrhoid back, because after defecation, the hemorrhoids prolapse out and stays outside. And you need to manually push it inside. And grade four is when there is a permanent prolapse. Okay, how do they, otherwise, grade one and two, how do they present? Anybody, how do they, I mean, see, because in grade one, there is no prolapse. Grade two, it's a prolapse and it goes in spontaneously. So the patient cannot see. And even if it is prolapsing, it's difficult for the patient to actually see it if it's, unless it is outside.
Yeah.
I think I see so it. Yes?
So, yeah, mostly it's asymptomatic or painless bleeding.
Okay. So bleeding is a common presentation. The next most common presentation is there is any pain. Okay, what about bleeding? Is there anything particularly important about the bleeding? Is there any way that you can identify whether this blood is from the hemorrhoids or somewhere higher up? Okay, good silence. What will be the, I'll give you a clue. What is the color of the
Press blood.
Yeah, it is bright red blood. Okay, so that is one way you can make out if it is low or down. I think I see Dr. Rajesh also. Can you introduce yourself, Dr. Rajesh? Welcome all the ARSA senior members. Dr. Rajesh is the secretary of the ARSA. Dr. Rajesh, you need to unmute.
Hello, everybody. Yeah. Hello, I'm Rajesh, secretary of ARSI. Welcome for this first video on this thing that on Zoom by Dr. Gyanaraj. I welcome all. Thank you. You can continue, Dr. Gyanaraj.
Yes. So, okay. I'm not found Dr. Sukumar Maiti yet. So, let him also, if he's there, can he introduce? And also have a look for all the other members so that we can join during the discussion. Okay, continuing back. So we were at the grades. Grade one, there is no prolapse. Grade two, it prolapses during defecation and spontaneously reduces. Grade three needs manual reduction, and grade four, permanent prolapse is there. So what are the symptoms? We learned that it's bleeding is one of the most common symptoms which is there. And of course, it can be associated with the pain. And then because there is soiling, there is quite a bit of itching, especially in the climates like we have here where the humidity is fairly high. And of course, when there is this grade 4 or there is prolapse, prolapse will always be there and that can cause injury and so on. And as mentioned earlier, if you ask the patient anything in that area, they'll either call it piles or hemorrhoids. So what are the investigations which are necessary? So of course, we need to do the routine investigation because we might have to do a surgical treatment. Then we look for occult blood. Then digital examination. But the most important examination is what we call endoscopy, or having a look inside. Earlier, we used to call it proctoscopy. So what are the precautions that you need to take when you're doing that? Anyone? I'm sure all of you would have done proctoscopy or endoscopies. And it's not a very pleasant experience. So what are the precautions you will take while doing it to make it more comfortable for the patient and for the doctor? Anyone? I think we have quite a lot of people, but I'll stop sharing. Somebody can tell us what are the precautions they'll take.
Hello.
Yes.
We should lubricate the proctoscope or the endoscope so that it doesn't damage the vein.
Yes, that's very important because I'm a urologist and we have a dictum in urology. Anything will go into anything else if well lubricated. So lubrication is very good. And what do you use for lubrication? So what are the materials which are available for lubrication? Okay, I can see Dr. Elijah, what lubrication do you use for proctoscopy and endoscopy?
Use water soluble gel like KY.
Okay, then? Anything else? Okay, a lot of people use local anesthetic gel, 2% xylocaine jelly or 5%. But any other things can be used?
We use simple Vaseline.
Yeah. Who said that?
Yeah. Radish.
Okay, fine.
Vaseline and with lignocaine.
See, what happens with the KY jelly, lignocaine, xylocaine jelly, all these commercial gels are quite expensive. And of course, for the benefit of the patient and the surgeon or doctor who's doing it, you need quite a lot of those lubrication. And Vaseline, the normal Vaseline is the least expensive material that they can use. And also it is superior in way of giving the lubrication. Because what we found is that it's far more comfortable to use Vaseline than xylocaine jelly. We also did a small study with the patients and we used, randomly used xylocaine jelly or Vaseline and found that Vaseline is superior. And coming to the management of hemorrhoids. What is the whole idea of the diet therapy? So why do you have to give a diet? So one of the reasons is that the way our diets are shifted over the years, because our diet leads to more of a constipation now, because we eat less fibers, we eat less fruits and vegetables. And also we actually tend to take less fluids. So these diet changes, if it's a mild grade 1 hemorrhoid or something like that, and occasional bleeding or mild pain, there is studies which have shown that change in diet habits can produce significant change when after a period of about 6 months of the change. Basically, what it does is it increases the bulk. or the stools and soften the stools. So this may be for those who don't want any other type of treatment, and they use the diet therapy. And what about, I don't know how many people are from medical colleges here. Have anyone used the venotonic agents like oral flavonoids or calcium dobutylate? Maybe Dr. Peter Reams can answer. Have you used that, Dr. Peter Reams?
No, I don't know it.
Okay, anyone else have they used it?
I'm Dr. Sukumar Maiti. Routinely, it is not used, but if there is associated bleeding, and sometimes we add this flavonoid, not in a routine all cases.
Is it available in India? What are those flavonoids?
I'm just talking about calcium dobutylate.
Okay.
It is available.
Is it expensive or not very expensive?
Not so expensive. It is available as 500 milligram tablets as well as 1000 milligram tablets. In severe cases, we prescribe 1000, and other times it is 500 BD, twice daily.
These are actually shown to be beneficial. About
whether it is effective or not, it is doubtful.
Okay. The Western literature say that it's about 50 to 67% of the patients benefit from it, especially when they compare it with the placebos. So it seems to be an option for grade 1 and grade 2 hemorrhoids. And if it's available, then it's well and good. That may be another thing which can be prescribed. And these, I really don't know how it acts, but it's supposed to increase the venous tone and prevent the venous stasis and so on. What about experience with the topical agents? That is one of those things like Proctosidil and what are the various ointment that we use? People have used glycerol trinitrate, nifedipine, phenylephrine, and so on. Dr. Peter Reams, do you use them in Netherlands or other places?
We'll use them especially for fissura ani, but so not as such for hemorrhoids. For hemorrhoids is basically, but you see, when we see them in surgical department, of course, it's a different thing. People will certainly get all these medications in the pharmacies out of office. They will do that in primary care, but once they are seen by the surgeon, we go for intervention.
Are these over-the-counter drugs, or does doctors have to prescribe?
Yeah, partly these you can get over-the-counter, yeah.
Okay. What about anyone has experience with nifedipine and phenylephrine ointments? Dr. Sukuma Maiti, do you have any experience with nifedipine ointment?
I have no experience of using the phenylephrine in hemorrhoids. And also in glycerin trinitrate, we are not using it for hemorrhoids. But sometimes we may get cases where hemorrhoids are associated with fissures. In that case, to reduce the spasm for the fissure, hemorrhoids have some etiological background of anal spasm, but most of the time we think that fissures are the usually caused by the spasm, but glycerin trinitrate will be used for the fissures, not for the hemorrhoids. But if it is associated with fissures, in those cases, it may be effective. Same thing with the nifedipine.
Okay, then what about Ayurvedic ointments and those sort of things? Does anyone have any experience with them? Ayurvedic, Himalaya, any of those sort of ointments?
In the market, one drug is very commonly available. That is the usually it was known as Thangudi, and now it is known as Sitcom. The composition is
Ithavia prostata,
and that drug is a course for usually 14 days, and we use prescribe in 14 days, really it is effective. I get the result, that is euphoria prostata extract. Okay. That is very commonly used in our place, and for 14 days therapy, within 14 days therapy, we get the effect of stoppage of breathing. But not for chronic grade 1 and grade 2, only when it is associated with breathing, we use it.
Okay. Then we go into what is called sclerotherapy. This again used to be an old method of treatment during student days. Earlier, we were using 5% phenol in oil or any of them. There are many brine or urea and so on. So this, the idea that if you inject it under the submucosa, it is supposed to cause more fibrosis and fix to the muscle underneath. The anal, the venous plexus or whatever it is between the mucosa and the underlying muscle. So if there is, initially we said part of the problem was that the elastic fibers, loose and connective tissue is not very strong. So if there is fibrosis, it can actually boost the mechanism or whatever it is and reduce the size of the anal cushions. But of course, here the problem is that if the injection is not given in the right place, it can cause a severe problem. And again, because you're introducing a needle through anus, so there is a possibility of infection there. So this also is not a very popular method, but can be used. And one of the least invasive popular method is a rubber band. This is meant usually for the grade 1 or grade 2 hemorrhoids, where as you can see, a rubber band is placed. Some of the applicators have like a Barron's apparatus. You go and catch it, and sometimes there's a suction which sucks the hemorrhoid tissue inside and places the rubber band. And this constricts vascularity, and slowly all this, a couple of days later, will fall off. And this area near where the constriction is will fibrose. And this can be applied one hemorrhoid at a time. We said there are three primary, one on the left side, two on the right side, 3, 7, and 11 o'clock positions. One at a time we can apply. And of course, recently we see a lot of advertisement and promotion about ablation therapies. We can use any of these methods, either infrared or radio frequency or cryotherapy. These, again, primarily they work by destroying the tissue. They're heating the tissues about 60 to 80% of 80 degrees centigrade. And it destroys the cells. And the resulting fibrosis will fix the muscle and the mucus layer. And of course, the flip side of that, all these are quite expensive and need equipment, which is expensive. Now, of course, the same thing can be done. The same ablation can be done using laser or harmonic or even the vessel sealer or other devices like automizers. Maybe Dr. Peter Reams can tell us about what is generally done in the West. Do they use any of these, and which cases do they use?
Well, what we basically do is because most people come in early stages of hemorrhoid disease. So let's say 90% are treated with rubber banding as outpatient in office treatment. And so the rare cases in stage 3 and 4, they are taken to theater. And then mostly it is done by classic surgical resection. Sometimes we used harmonic scalpel or other ultra-scission devices. But of course it's much more expensive. It will cost an extra $200 to the hospital, not to the patient. And there are some techniques like hemorrhoidopexy. So then you just lift up.
I get that.
Yeah, so you lift up with a few stitches, and all the other treatments have been experienced. Especially one time it was popular to use this PPP device, this circular device, which would give a circular stapler inside.
Yeah.
But to be honest, I've seen it in my own hospital, and I've heard in symposia that we were not the only to have this complication. Although it is very rare, if you take with the PPP device the full thickness, so apart from the mucosa, you take full thickness rectum. One of our colleagues, he inflicted on a patient a hole in the rectum. And that patient was only treated with colonoscopy and then later rectal resection with coronary anal anastomosis. So a very, very, very serious complication for benign disease. So most of our colleagues, they have stopped this because although it is rare, even if you have it in 1 in 1,000, it is still a very, very bad complication. So we have skipped using this device, which was highly promoted by pharmaceutical companies because it would give no pain. And of course, pain is the main complication of classic hemorrhoidal surgery, but it's temporary. So that's basically our approach now.
Okay, thank you. Again, this shows the, of course, you talked about this before I could go on to the thing. See, this is, I mean, what is promoted, as Dr. Peter Rehm said, is the ideal treatment of prolapsed hemorrhoids because it slides. So once you resect a portion of the mucosa, it's supposed to lift back the redundant hemorrhoid tissue. And the other therapy is that if there is any, because one of the causative agents is supposed to be the high vascular pressures in the hemorrhoid artery. Then there are some devices, I don't know whether they is commonly used now to ligate the artery with a guided therapy. I think I see a note saying that two people want to ask something. Does anybody want to ask any questions now to anyone?
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I had a question that, you told that in piles or something, there is bleeding when we pass the stool, right?
Yes.
So there may be some internal injuries or any infections there. So that might not be the case of hemorrhoids. Then how will we specifically tell that there are hemorrhoids or something?
See, the diagnosis of hemorrhoids is done through anoscopy or proctoscopy. You see the dilated anal cushions. So if there are only three dilated, I think I'll go back to the slides, you can see. Here, this is... Here, the entire area is dilated with these cushion-like tissues, vascular tissues. The opening will be somewhere here. So here also, we'll see C primary, even though they classically say that it's in 3 o'clock, 7 and 11. You'll see the dilatation all around. So the diagnosis is made primarily by having a look inside by anoscopy or proctoscopy. And obviously, if there is bleeding, you need to rule out. One of the major things which you are worried about is malignancies. And that is the reason why, even in Vellore those days, we used to do sigmoidoscopy or even colonoscopy to rule out any malignancies higher up. But then, as Dr. O.P. Narayanan said earlier, the bleeding with hemorrhoid is bright red color. While if it is from malignancy higher up, or they'll be more altered and more darker. And here the stools will be streaked with blood. While when if the bleeding is higher up, they'll be mixed with blood. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Yeah.
Excuse me, sir. I had a couple of questions.
Yes.
In case of dissection of the hemorrhoid, or if we use the rubber band to block it, there will be open injury in that region. So we will pass the stool after that also. The patient will pass the stool after that also. So won't there be a higher risk of infection?
See, what happens is that, if this is a hemorrhoid tissue, the rubber band constricts. Okay, so it doesn't... it slowly decreases the blood supply, strangulates, and the rest of the area which is outside falls off. The area where the rubber band is there, that heals. So usually, if you have surgical incision, the way it heals is that within 48 hours, there's a platelet covering, which makes it bacteria-proof or nothing goes inside. So here also, the area within the rubber band is healed. And the rubber band and the tissue fall off only after the healing occurs in this area. So generally, unless there is an injury, so that the rubber band slips or anything, nothing happens.
When the bleeding is occurring from the hemorrhoids, there is a little bit of puncture in the hemorrhoid. So, from there, infection can occur.
Yeah, that will be distal to the rubber band. So, okay. That bleeding will be there. Because anyway, you are constricting and that sort of bleeding will be there. Dr. Maithi, do you want to answer it? Dr. Sukumar Maithi?
The student, actually he is a student of our medical college.
Yeah.
One thing, the bleeding from the hemorrhoids is not always directly from the ulcers. It is very thinned out mucous membrane and through which the blood may come out, and macroscopically you may not find any ulcer. And incidentally, the rectal mucous membrane or the anal skin is rather more immune to infection to the rest of our body. Our anal area is to some extent resistant from the other tissues. The rubber band digestion, following rubber band digestion, the tissue distal to the band is actually will fall off, and it has no circulation. So if there is no circulation, the chance of infection to the avascular area is less. It will be necrosed and will fall off. But it is not free from infections. In some cases, if the patient is immunocompromised, or in that case, the chance of infection is still there. All the patients, I hope, should receive the antibiotics and proper perineal care. For example, after your procedure, some rectal wash with povidone iodine daily basis may help to prevent the infection. The chance of infection is still there. But that is not incidence is not too high. That is very low. And another thing, in case of prolapse, hemorrhoids, the cause of bleeding may not be due to the presence of hemorrhoid. The cause of bleeding may be the associated malignancy and also the fissure we have discussed and other causes. Another thing we must remember that all patients who have hemorrhoids may not produce any symptom, particularly grade 1 and grade 2. And all patients having hemorrhoids may not require any treatment until and unless it is symptomatic. So, for example, a patient with grade 1 hemorrhoid may not produce bleeding. But if it is in an elderly patient, and if it is in a patient with hypertension, the same hemorrhoid which is non-problematic in a young patient may be problematic. So, individual variation is there in the presence of hemorrhoid. So, we should think about the patient as a case, as a patient, not should our concentrated mind on that particular swelling itself in the anorectal region. Other confusion which usually we find that occurs in diagnosis of hemorrhoid is the sentinel piles. Sentinel piles is the hypertrophic skin tag associated with fissure. sometimes the skin tag is so enlarged, particularly if it is associated with inflammation, then it gives a significant swelling. And many a times it is confused as hemorrhoid. Unfortunately, the term piles is added to that skin tag. In the layman's term, piles means hemorrhoid. But here in analgesia, the skin tag which is attached, that is called piles, sentinel piles. But truly speaking, it is not the piles. Another conclusion we sometimes see when there is prolapse of the rectum, partial mucosal prolapse. Particularly in a total complete prolapse, the diagnosis is not difficult. It is circumferential prolapse. But if there is a small mucosal prolapse at a particular segment of the anal opening, so there is a lot of confusion whether it is really prolapse or the hemorrhoids. Most of the time, there is difference in color. The prolapse mucous membrane has a typical pinkish color, but the hemorrhoids are usually blackish pink in color. And the bleeding from the mucosal prolapse is extremely rare until and unless it is ulcered by trauma. In mucosal prolapse, there is usually no bleeding, but in hemorrhoids, there is bleeding. So these things I can comment, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, going back to the... This is probably one treatment which is of historical interest. It's a clamp and cautery method. So special Smith clamp is there for catching the hemorrhoid. And you cut around the clamp and cauterize it. And again, apparently, you need to use a copper wire cautery, which slowly seals the vessels. If you use a regular electrocautery, it bleeds apparently. So nowadays, probably neither the pile clamp nor the copper wire cautery might not be available now. But then this is just for interesting, I'm mentioning this. And the standard treatment, this is almost devised more than 100 years ago, which is still being practiced, is a V-shaped incision which excises the hemorrhoids and ligates near the tip of the hemorrhoid. And you leave a little bit of skin tag all around so that when there is when it heals, no stricture in that area. And of course, there are other methods of dissection where you make an incision in the mucosa, open it, remove the hemorrhoidal tissue, and then close it. And there's some methods, they don't close it. Then some people plicate the hemorrhoid tissue. And of course, the stapled hemorrhoids are there. And this is a new thing. I don't know, Dr. Peter Rims, have you seen the Doppler-guided hemorrhoidal artery ligation?
Yeah, I've seen people doing this, but I don't think in all kind of randomized studies that is really superior above classical Milligan-Morgan. So,
but what the literature says is some patients, the hemorrhoid occurs because of the higher pressure in the superior hemorrhoidal artery.
Yeah, there is
it's supposed to be beneficial.
Yeah, there's theoretical advantage in this, but it is not so easy to find exactly the good artery which is responsible of your concussion.
And the recent modification, which, one of the problem with the hemorrhoid surgery is that sometimes there can be a significant bleeding. If there is, to avoid the bleeding, the same open surgical method which you classically do can be done using either a harmonic scalpel or a vessel sealer device. And this, you make the surgery is much more clean and without bleeding. And because of that, the patients also feel much better. But the surgery in terms of the what you do is exactly the same as the regular open surgery. And of course, all these, one of the, I mean, the complications which Dr. Peter Reams pointed out earlier was that there is significant post-operative pain. And of course, as he mentioned earlier, the stapled hemorrhoidectomy is supposed to reduce the pain. And there can be significant bleeding, infection, sepsis, incontinence, and so on. This you need to understand. And of course, recently I see in Facebook, everywhere, there's a lot of advertisement about these laser procedures. Now, that's in short about the presentation that we had. So now I'll like to ask the faculty, especially the people from medical colleges and other things, a couple of questions to how...
So I had a question.
Yes. Yes, go ahead, please.
Yes, sir. Recently you told us about cauterization. So my question was, what's the difference between cauterization and infrared coagulation, like photocoagulation?
See, the cauterization they're talking about is using the copper wire at the base of the plemina, say when you cauterize blood vessels or tissues. So basically what it does is slowly heats up the tissue to about 70 to 80 degrees centigrade, which coagulates all the vessels and there is no bleeding. And the vessel sealing also does exactly the same thing like regular cautery. But regular cautery, you don't have control about how much current passes, how much heating occurs, and how quickly it occurs. So the vessel sealing, the principle is that it allows the current to pass slowly and gives a feedback when there is total coagulation, no bleeding. And there's a question about... laxatives. Dr. Sukumar Maiti, do you use laxatives or you don't use laxatives?
Actually, I asked the patient about his symptom or the bowel habit. Mm. If the patient says he has or she has no problem with the bowel movement, for the preoperative cases, that depends how much is the bowel, how is the bowel habit. If there is constipation, only then I use the laxative. In postoperative patient, always I prefer laxatives at least for a few weeks because of the presence of the wound and the associated spasm in the anal sphincters. The liquid stool is preferable than the, your solid hard stool. Hard stool can cause more pain, and sometimes we get cases if the patient does not turn in the follow-up. She has or she has come with impacted heart stool. That becomes very difficult to manage in the postoperative period in the setting of presence of wounds, open wounds in the anal region where there is heart stool impacted high enough. So in postoperative patient, in all following all hemorrhoidectomy, I use the laxatives.
Okay. So now coming to, are there any differences in treating hemorrhoids in rural areas as compared to urban areas or medical colleges?
Dr. Ganagar, one question. I want to know from Peter and you and other faculty present. So do you add internal sphincterotomy when there are multiple site hemorrhoidectomy? For example, 3 or 4 hemorrhoids which are excised by open procedure, whether we will add internal sphincterotomy or not, because many a patient may get severe spasmodic pain in the postoperative period. Whether your experience is that internal sphincterotomy somehow relieves some amount of spasm and the patient is remain symptom free from pain. Your comment or your practice?
Maybe I would not do that, no. I can understand it would be the idea, of course, it's interesting, but on the other side, what I train my trainees is to look for the internal sphincter And once you have seen it, to avoid damaging it, only then you proceed to remove the hemorrhoids. So you make your incision in the mucosa, at the edge of the mucosa and the skin, you go for the internal sphincter, and then you see it and you keep it aside, and then you remove the tissue above it so that you have a good view. And also you have a very good control about the bleeding because you see exactly what you are stitching. But what I would suggest then, but then of course it might be again expensive, but if you have a good results with the internal sphincterotomy to do, you could then of course, because it's a temporary measure, you could apply Botox in the internal sphincter to get the same effect, but then it's temporary. But I have no experience doing that apart from fissure treatment, but not for hemorrhoids. But that might be an idea to do, and could be very interesting then.
Okay, that is a good idea. But Botox is very costly.
Yeah.
And alternative to Botox, what myself or some of my friends also do, inject Lignocaine.
In place
of Botox, that is Lignocaine is introduced.
Can
give some, at least sensor can, because it is a long-acting Lignocaine. Sensor can, it is diluted and injected in that area, and its effect persists for a few days at least.
Yeah.
One of the procedures which I did not list in the PowerPoint is Lott's procedure or four-finger dilatation, which is also described for hemorrhoids, which is similar to the lateral anal sphincterotomy, but it sort of damages the sphincter much more. But then when we were training trainees in CMC Vello, they were advocating, some of the surgeons were advocating lateral anal sphincterotomy along with the hemorrhoidectomy, especially as Dr. Maiti said, for the large hemorrhoids. So that time what we did was, we did a small randomized study in Vello, one of the postgraduates, but found no significant difference between the group which had a lateral anal sphincterotomy or not, the other group also.
Another comment I like to get from Gonoraj, Dr. Peter, and other faculty, whether as we are in India, role of yoga in the treatment of hemorrhoids, whether yoga may play some role.
You're not able to. I think there's a lot of external voice. Everybody.
That the pranayam, that is the contraction, relaxation of the anal sphincter muscle in the position of Poddasana, is useful. I do practice. I do advise for my patients to do that practice of pranayam for the anal sphincters, exercise for the anal sphincters. I don't know what you do or whether you have any belief on the on this yoga practice.
I have not prescribed yoga or not used it also. So I don't really have any experience. What about Dr. Peter Reams?
No, sorry. I have no experience with that. No.
So now coming to talking about differences between tackling hemorrhoids in Western area, Western countries or medical colleges, larger places versus rural areas. Is there anything, any difference do you think is there? So earlier I wanted to know because apparently the stapler for prolapsed or grade 4 hemorrhoids is supposed to be the ideal. But after hearing from Dr. Peter Reams, even in West, if they don't advocate it, there's no point in advocating that in rural areas. Would you agree with that, Dr. Sukumar, Maiti? Dr. Reams, what would your comments on be?
I think basically there should be not too much difference between hemorrhoid treatment throughout in rural areas and specialized areas. But apart from, let's say, the technological advancements with Doppler and sonography and localized treatment with with vessel ligation, of course, you need maybe a more specialized center to do studies on that. But basically, I think it should be easily performed in all areas throughout the world.
Okay, so the investigation wise, there is no difference because you don't do any apart from local ultrasound and Doppler and all that. And of course, the pressure studies in the superior hemorrhoidal artery. These are specialized investigation which are probably not necessary. Would everyone agree with that? It's not necessary to do any of these specialized investigations. Or are there any special instances where these may be necessary? Again, probably Dr. Peter Reams has to answer. Is there any specialized instances where these studies may be required for patient with hemorrhoid? These special investigations?
Well, the only remark you can make is that rubber band ligation is not widely available in African countries, especially in the rural areas. So, for example, in Uganda, where I come every year, unfortunately, we don't have the rubber band ligation. And of course, patients usually present in these rural areas in later stages of disease. So most patients who come, they are too late to be treated with rubber band ligation. But the other way is also true, that if you have an early stage disease, which normally you would easily treat in your office with rubber band ligation, it's not always available because it needs a little bit of investment to have this treatment possibility.
Okay, just to add to that, have you used Foley's catheter as rubber bands? See, many of the places, the rubber bands are not available. They may have an applicator. And whoever sells them, unfortunately, don't sell them sufficient rubber bands, or they use it up. So what we have found is you can cut Foley's catheter into small strips. And they are, in fact, as effective, or if not more effective, than the rubber bands. So that's one thing which you can add to the rural areas.
Thanks.
So investigations, probably there is no advantage of offering these specialized investigations like Doppler studies, or I don't know how they measure the rectal pressure or the pressure in the superior rectal artery. But then, as we heard from Dr. Peter Reams, those surgeries are difficult, expensive, and not results are not as good. And complications can, so sometimes even serious complications can occur for a benign disease, which is not acceptable. So most of them common, I mean, the probably only investigation that you'll need is proctoscopy or endoscopy to have a look and decide on the grade of the hemorrhoid. And then the conservative treatment also doesn't have, I mean, of course, Dr. Sukumar Maiti said the venotonic agents do work. But if there is pain, those local anesthetic or local ointment, nifedipine, and those sort of ointments also can be of use. But then smaller grades, rubber banding is the ideal surgery. And for larger grades, grade 3 and 4, the classical surgery. And if facilities are available, you can use a vessel sealer or harmonic to have less bleeding. So that, Dr. Sukumar Maiti, would you agree with that recommendation, or would you like
actually,
to add anything
else? Very nicely discussed by you, Dr. Peter. But one comment I'd like to make, that still the etiopathology or etiogenesis of hemorrhoids is in the form of evolution. There are no treatment is 100% acceptable. There are pros and cons, merits and demerits of all the treatments. And one comment I like to make about the rubber band ligation. Rubber band ligation may not be available in the rural areas, but what the surgeons can do, instead of using the machine, they can apply this same technique. They can pull the hemorrhoid with a Babcock forceps, which is less traumatizing, and then put a ligature making a iatrogenic pedicle. So once the hemorrhoid is pulled, you can produce a narrow pedicle and you can apply a suture ligature and excise the distal part on the operation table so that we not wait for the gangrenous tissue to fall subsequently. On the table, we can excise the tumor with a band. Instead of band, there is a ligature and we can cauterize the surface. There will be no bleeding. That is a very good alternative of rubber band ligation. And one thing we should remember that two procedures may be combined together. For example, if the same patient has primary hemorrhoids at three sites, at 3, 5, and 7 o'clock position, or other three primary sites, and there may be multiple small secondary hemorrhoids. In those cases, the hemorrhoidectomy or excision can be done for the primary hemorrhoids. And if we try to excise also the secondary hemorrhoids by the same technique, the chance of stricture formation is very high. So in that case, we should combine in some of the cases the primary excision with incision, and in others, we will do the procedure what I have described as alternative to rubber band. And that will ensure the continuity of the mucous membrane around the anal canal or rectum. If the rectal mucosa is not maintained as a breeze between the wounds, then there is chance of stricture formation. So this ligation excision and the hemorrhoidectomy may be combined particularly in grade 4 or the circumferential hemorrhoids. That comment I like to make. Otherwise, the complications will be very high.
So just one more question. The rubber band can be done and without anesthesia. So what the recommend is that under local or without anesthesia, you can just put in the rubber band. But the excision that you are describing would need anesthesia.
Truly speaking, if it is properly done with the help of proctoscope, the anesthesia may not be required because the rectal area is not sensitive. The rubber band which is used, that is applied to area which is insensitive. For that reason, anesthesia is not needed.
Even the rubber band has to be above the dentate line. If you do anything below the dentate line, it is painful.
That should be also above the dentate line.
Yeah. Okay, I think we're to the end of the time. Any questions you can type in or last comments from the faculty and then we'll close.
One question or comment was from the participant, the role of Kharsutra. The Kharsutra actually used for the fissures, for the fistulas. Probably it is not applicable for the hemorrhoids. Mm-hmm. One comment that just came out and just disappeared. That is, What is the role of Kharsutra? That is Ayurvedic, vegetable fiber, which is very effective maybe for the fistulas, but may not be used for the hemorrhoids.
And Dr. Peter James, would you like to make any closing comments before we close?
Oh, thank you. It's very, very interesting and very nice to be with so many people around. So we'll continue with this and hopefully more participants from more rural areas in the world will be interested in this. It's really good. Yeah.
Thank you. And for everyone, I think I gave the link for the rules, International Federation of Rural Surgeons YouTube link. This lecture also will probably put it up so that in future, if you want to have a closer look at it or look at it again, you can do it. And when we have time, we'll make summaries of these and then put that also up in the YouTube. So please subscribe to both the Rural Surgery Doctors channel, IFRS, and the Patient Education channel on that. So then every week we'll try and for next week is 27th. So after that, do you have any topics that you want to discuss or we'll decide that later?
At the moment, I cannot say about that. Every week may not be possible for me to join.
Yeah, anybody can join. So whoever is there.
So I'm not sure the next week. Today, I'm just from the OT. I could finish at 8:30, then join.
Okay, anyway, thanks everyone for joining. You can, if you are interested in any topics that you would like us to discuss.
If any topic comes from the audience, the members, or
you can send us any topic,
please give it and circulate it so that more members will join as this for today. Today we have seen about 64 members have joined.
At one time, 71 were there. So.
72 members. Okay, that is good.
Okay, then. Thank you very much. Good night. Bye.